Thank you for joining me for another edition of the Bob Sullivan Show. Today I have on with me from the GiantsPod podcast, Thomas Todd. How are you doing today, Thomas?
Oh, I'm doing great. Just as good as I can be after a 3-7 homestand.
Oh, yeah. I mean, what's going on with the Giants right now? I mean, the Giants are struggling a little bit. The Dodgers are struggling. And where the hell did the Diamondbacks come from? They're all of a sudden playing well.
Well, look, they were getting pesky before the All-Star break, and then had a little bit of a letdown, so they went down about 7 games. But I think they're probably the second-best team in the division. I think they're better than the Dodgers, even after all the trade deadline moves.
Do you think that who do you think bettered themselves with the Phillies giving up, basically, the Dodgers or the Giants?
It's pretty 50-50 at this point. You know, the Dodgers got help on the left side of the infield with Hanley Ramirez. They got some outfield help. The Giants were just looking for depth. You know, Marco Scudero can play almost any position in the infield, and that's helpful with Brandon Crawford and Ryan Terrio not being sluggers. And Hunter Pence in the outfield, you know, creates competition. There's definitely needed because Gregor Blanco and Angel Pagan have not been playing well. So now they have to battle over one spot, and, you know, maybe that's going to give the Giants more production in the outfield. But so far, in the first couple games, it hasn't shown, but if the Giants fans are patient, they're going to probably reap rewards in the end.
What, with, Lincecum had a decent, his last outing was pretty good. Do you think that his struggles are over? Do you think that, this is just kind of a one-year thing? What do you think long-term for Lincecum?
You know, I've been kind of sitting on this all year, just watching and waiting, and I finally figured out, I think, coming into the season, he lost 22 pounds. Now, when you're a starting pitcher in Major League Baseball, you need weight behind your pitches. You know, Matt Cain's a solid 210. You know, you got big guys like CC Sabathia. You know, you got some weight behind those pitches. So when Lincecum was weighing, you know, 170, 175, he was fine because he had all that extra torque from his windup. But after losing weight, I think the torque doesn't make up for it. So he's losing velocity. He's not able to finish his pitches, can't find the zone with his fastball. I think he needs to put on weight in the offseason, but for now he just needs to bear down, and like he has in the last 3 of his last 4 starts, he's been good, but there's still things to be desired.
Do you think that he's ever going to ditch the crazy motion he does?
No, I mean, he's been doing that since pretty much day one of his career. That's the, you know, windup his father taught him, and, you know, he's got to dance with the one that brought you there.
Well, I mean, he's been a little hot and cold. The Giants, I mean, they've been kind of, I mean, it's hard to read them because, I mean, they look like $1 million, and then the next day, I mean, as a Giants fan, it can't be easy being a Giants fan. I mean, the World Series has to be a nice feeling to avoid, like, me being a Knicks fan, I understand the pain of never winning for 40 years. Well, yours was 60, but what is it like with the Giants right now, watching them just one day it's their pitching, one day it's their hitting, that's not showing up?
Well, it's frustrating, and you know, we've been pretty healthy this season aside from not getting Freddy Sanchez back, and this is Pablo Sandoval's second trip to the DL, so we've been grateful that we've been healthy, but you know, like you said, the bullpen kind of fell apart at times. Three hits against the Mets. Come on, you got to do better than 3 hits against the Mets. So it is frustrating, but at the same time, Sabian has made moves that are going to improve the team. Buster Posey's going to get locked up to a long-term contract. We have Matt Cain for the next 5 or 6 years. So the Giants' window is open, whether they take advantage of it this year or not. The fans should be happy that they're spending money and making good acquisitions.
Did they give up anything of note for Hunter Pence, or were they kind of coin flips what they gave up?
Well, all prospects are coin flips. You know, until someone's proven something in the big leagues, you know, Nate Sjerholz is a non-prospect. You know, he had a home run in his first game, which was good to see because he really wanted playing time, and that's why kind of why they traded him. Tommy Joseph is a catching prospect in the Giants system. His upside, you know, obviously, his upside's Mike Napoli. He's a power-hitting catcher. With solid defense behind the plate. But like I said, until you see it at the big league level, you just don't know. Also, the Giants have catching depth. Buster Posey, like I said, is going to be locked up. Hector Sanchez. Sanchez is a pretty good bat at 22. So, you know, the Giants have catching depth, so Tommy Joseph is definitely a piece to trade away. And good for the Phillies for getting a nice catching prospect, but the Giants aren't too upset about losing Tommy Joseph.
Brandon Belt, I've noticed that there's been a little bit of bitterness towards Brandon Belt, a little bit from Giants fans. What's going on with Brandon Belt? Is he, do you think he's going to be a miss?
Well, there's a lot of Giants fans who are surprised he wasn't traded. I personally was not surprised because he is an asset, and anytime you can get a prospect in your corner infield, you got to give him time. You know, he's seen very few pitches in any level. You know, he came in late at 22 and got moved up quickly, and maybe he got to the big leagues too fast, and he has struggled to fix the hold in his swing and find his power. But Giants fans and the Giants themselves need to be patient. You know, you can't get immediate production all the time. It's not like when Buster Posey came up and just started swinging, and he's going to swing like that for 10 years. It doesn't always work like that. So the Giants need to be patient, but in the meantime, look for Pablo Sandoval to play first base when he comes back, with Scooter at third, frustrating just about every stat Eric Giants fan in the world.
Well, were you, like, what was the most surprising move that the Giants didn't make at the trade deadline? Did you see the Hunter Pence deal coming? Because I didn't see that one. I didn't see the Hunter Pence even getting moved. I just figured he would stay in Philly. I figured Victorino would move, and that was about the extent of what the Phillies would do. I was shocked Hunter Pence moved. Did you see any moves that you were surprised by that the Giants didn't make?
Well, I saw Pence moving for sure because the Phillies, you know, they were out of contention essentially. And, you know, anyone you have under team control who's not going to be there when you're actually good, which is Hunter Pence, because they're probably in like a 3-year rebuild. They're only going to have for another year. So you might as well flip up the prospect that you're going to have for a few years under your control. But I saw that move coming. I really thought the Giants were going to make a move to get some bullpen peps. Let's run Brad Penny out there. Yeah. You know, George Contos has been good, but he's an unknown quantity. Clay Hensley's still, you know, wishy-washy. So, Giants need bullpen help, but look for them to get that on the waiver wire in August. There's always people available in August.
What do you think? Recently there hasn't been huge. I mean, there's never a huge waiver wire move, but what do you think is going to be the biggest waiver wire deal done this year?
These things are so incredibly unpredictable. I mean, with the Giants in 2010, we always talk about this because it's our World Series year. But we got Cody Ross off waivers. We got Pat Burrell on waivers. So those two guys, if we don't have them, we don't win the World Series. So, I don't know if there's specific guys out there looking to get dropped and picked up, but the Giants are going to be hunting. You know, Fabian's a bargain bin kind of guy. He goes to the dollar store, and sometimes he comes back with a treasure, and sometimes he comes back with Jose Guillen. So look for the Giants to make moves. I honestly couldn't tell you names because I don't dig as deep in the dumpster as Fabian does.
Well, as far as the NL West goes, it really, the Rockies and Padres are the only two out of it. We got Dodgers, Giants, Diamondbacks. Which one of the, do you think it's going to be a three team with both teams winning the wild card, or do you think it's just going to be a two team division making the playoffs?
Man, that's tough to say. All three teams are primed to make a run. You know, the Giants are struggling now, but they've added pieces. I think the pitching will win out. The Dodgers, if they hadn't made the Hanley Ramirez and Chan Victorino trades, I would have said they would fade to relative obscurity. But man, their lineup's actually pretty good now, and they've kept Juano solid in that rotation. I really, you know, I didn't want them to get a starting pitcher, but I thought they would get a starting pitcher, and then they would be the favorites. But at this point, I might even pick the Diamondbacks to win the division, just because they're the most balanced and consistent team on both offense and on the mound.
I never, like, with how poorly they started off, I'm shocked that they're even in contention right now. I mean, they were probably everybody liked them as to win the division, but as soon as injuries hit, it was just like, okay, this team's done. Now they've kind of had like a Rockies type run here in the, granted it's not a September run, but it's a July, I guess it'd be more like an Oakland A's type of run.
Yeah,
Do you see them being able to compete for a to win the NL, or do you think that they who do you think is the class of the NL right now?
Well, here's what the preseason narrative was on the Diamondbacks. They overachieved last year. They won probably 6 or 7 games more than they should have. So coming into this season, the key word was regression. Diamondbacks are going to regress. But they added Trevor Cahill, and they still have good hitters, and no one else in the NL West is blowing anyone away. There's no Yankees or Rangers or teams like that that are just crushing the ball. So the Diamondbacks, yeah, they're a contender. The National League's kind of up in the air right now. The Nationals are solid. They're always looking to add pieces. The Braves are a pretty good team. You can never count out the Cardinals, man. Those kids can hit. So I think the Diamondbacks are probably the third or fourth best team in the National League right now.
What's your take on the Nationals right now? Do you think that they can afford to shut down Strasburg? Or do you think that, I mean, I think it's risky to shut down a guy. Granted, he has a high ceiling for the future, but when you got a shot to make the World Series, I think you got to take it. And with Strasburg, with or without Strasburg, they probably have a chance, but Strasburg wouldn't hurt to have him in the playoffs.
No, I honestly don't think they have a chance without Strasburg. I think, you know, you can't just shut down your ace and expect to go deep in the playoffs, you know. I know they gave 160 as a number before the season, but now they're saying, oh, we never set a number now that they're contending. So I think what they're going to do is selectively skip a start here and there. You know, he rarely pitches past the 6th or 7th inning, so I think they're limiting his innings in a different way than just capping him and removing him. So I think he's going to be there in the playoffs if the Nationals do end up making it, and, you know, I'm afraid of him if that does happen.
What do you think if... I think they should. I wouldn't think it would be a bad idea to move him to the bullpen. If they wanted to really just cap his innings, have his bullpen sessions be out of the pen and control him that way versus just shutting him down altogether. Because I just don't see how removing him altogether from the equation should even be an option.
Yeah, I see what you mean, trying to get some value out of you know, what might be a sunk cost if you have to completely pull them out. But you don't want to mess around with your guy's head. Look at the guys they've tried to move from the bullpen to the rotation or vice versa, you know. Daniel Bard's been jerked around. It hasn't worked out well for him. Chris Sale's having arm problems because he kept going back and forth. So I really don't think that's a good idea. I think they just skip a few starts and rest him up for the playoffs if they look like they have a nice little lead.
Who do you right now see that is in the playoff hunt that you see falling off? Do you see a Pirates drop off? You see, I mean, Cincinnati's been playing unbelievable right now. Do you see them dropping? I don't see them missing the playoffs, but I see a drop off. What teams do you see potentially dropping off before the playoffs?
I don't want to say it, but, you know, we're all waiting for the Pirates bottom to drop out. They do have a good team. Andrew McCutcheon's an MVP candidate. Neil Walker's tearing the cover off the ball. Their rotation is solid. But, man, we're all just waiting for it to happen. Personally, as a Giants fan, I love when the Pirates succeed because we kind of stole Barry Bonds in the early 90s, and they haven't had a winning season since. So there's a whole guilt of Giants fans. So we're all rooting for the Pirates, but I do see them possibly dropping off. The Reds, like you said, will get worse, but they'll still make the playoffs. I'm hoping it's the Dodgers that drop off and don't make the playoffs, so that's just my Giants fan mentality.
Well, and who knows if Andrew McCutcheon ends up winning the MVP and getting the Pirates to the NLCS and losing to the Braves. You never know. Andrew McCutcheon could be the next Bonds. Coming over to
the Braves. Well, I mean, didn't they lock him up, though?
Yeah, but, I mean, anything can... It's the Pirates. Anything can happen. with the Giants and Dodgers, I've always wanted to see a Dodgers Giants NLCS. I haven't seen it in my lifetime, and I've just always been fascinated by that rivalry. Do you think ESPN would finally start looking at that rivalry if there was an NLCS, or do you think ESPN gives enough credit to that rivalry?
I think they give some credit to the rivalry. And the reason they haven't in the last decade is because the teams haven't been good at the same time in a while. You know, the Giants kind of peaked in 02, had a great 03, 04 was decent, and then they went in the tank. And that's when the Dodgers were getting good at making a playoff. So it's really only a good rivalry, even Yankees Red Sox, when both teams are good. Mm-hmm. That's why it's been all over Sunday Night Baseball the last few years. So look for the next few years to really be the renaissance of the Giants-Dodgers rivalry. Both teams, I think, are going to be loaded and set up to try to win that division for the next 3 or 4 years.
Are you concerned with the new ownership in L.A.? As a Giants fan, are you concerned with the now that they have resources to use, that they will most likely use them? Does that concern you at all?
I'm scared to death. I mean, it definitely, I think it shortens the Giants' window, theoretically, but also the team has to make the right moves. Can't just buy a championship. You know, the Yankees did it. You know, the Red Sox spent a lot of money and won a couple titles, but, you know, with a lot of teams spending money now, the Rangers are going to be spending just as much as the Dodgers. They had that big TV deal. Lots of teams are spending, so I'm not really too worried about the Dodgers because they still have to make the right moves despite having lots of money.
With the overall in the National League, do you see who's going to get the number one overall pick in the draft next year? Do you think it's going to be Houston? Do you think Houston has that locked up?
Look, I think they could win every game the rest of the season and still get that pick. You know, they didn't win their 10th road game until I think a week and a half ago. They just had a ridiculous season. My favorite Houston anecdote at the trade deadline, I think Buster only tweeted that every one of the Astros was in play to be traded was over 5'5". Meaning, Jose Altuve was the only guy untouchable. I thought that was good.
I think it's weird that he's even untouchable because I've never been tremendously impressed with. I mean, he's good, but I don't think he's a cornerstone. Do you?
I do and I don't. I don't think, you know, he's not Joey Votto, but he plays a pretty premium position in the middle infield. And you're talking to a guy who, in the last few years, has talked himself into Manny Burris and Ryan Terrio and Mike Montano at starting second baseman. So anytime you can get even middling production around 300, you got to take it.
Well, well, as long as he's not coming from the Cubs to the Giants at a second baseman, you wouldn't be fretting, I would guess.
No, definitely not. I just recently read the Alfonso Soriano story where he rejected the trade to the Giants. I was like, well, thanks, Alfonso. You did me a favor. I don't have to watch you play defense.
And not to mention, it's a bigger field. Imagine how big a disaster that would be with him in left field. Like, that would be worse than Bonds at the end of his career in left field.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we put some gems out there recently. We've had Aubrey Huff at night, Pat Burrell at left. We've had some atrocious defense out there in the last few seasons. But that series in Chicago where the Giants swept the Cubs in four games, I think Soriano just kicked the ball around all series. He also hit a home run, but honestly, that guy, he does not belong in the outfield.
Why don't you think, what do you think the Cubs are like? Do you think that Theo is going to make things right there, or do you think it's fool's gold?
The only way to make things right in Chicago is to win the World Series. And that's tough. You know, the best GMs in the world don't win the World Series in every sport, or the Super Bowl, or whatever. But the Cubs fans are patient. You know, they're giving Theo a 5-year plan and saying, hey, if you can't make us good in 5 years, time to find another solution. When you have a tortured fan base like that, they will wait. You know, if you waited 102 years, why not wait 107? Yeah. So they are being patient, and I think Theo's going to be able to do some good things. He's going to get out from under bad contracts. He's going to have to draft his guys. He's going to have to trade for his guys. And I think he's got a lot of friends and other GMs who give him good deals. They got Anthony Rizzo for pretty much free for an injured bullpen prospect. So I think he's going to be good, and I think the Cubs are going to, in 5 years, be a contender.
Giants-wise, this season, what do you think the ceiling is? What's the ceiling, and how far do you, what do you think the basement is for them? Like, how far do you think they can fall? How high do you think they can go?
Well, I wrote before the season started, and I think I wrote this before last season too, was that the Giants are going to struggle to make the playoffs. But once they make the playoffs, they're set up nicely. It's hard for the Giants to win regular season games because we're throwing Barry Zito out there, you know, throwing out a bad offense. But once the playoffs start, you know, starting pitching takes over, they're solid on defense. So I think they're, obviously, their floor is just they don't make the playoffs and they have to retool for next year. But the ceiling, of course, is another World Series. When you're throwing out guys like Lincecum, Bumgarner, Kane, and the ever-surprising Ryan Vogelsong, you throw those four guys out, you can win any series. Could maybe against the Yankees. But, you know, the ceiling is the World Series, and the floor is not making the playoffs. And that's such a range of emotions that drives Giants fans nuts.
Well, yeah, and they have the biggest, I mean, they probably have the biggest range of things that can possibly happen to them. The, like you said, they have the pitching to when they're in the playoffs that they can dominate anybody. But I mean, if you look at it, like watching those games, that's tough. I mean, I'm not even a Giants fan, and it's miserable to watch those games, just day in day out, because you never know what the hell you're gonna get. And in the playoffs, that's actually a good thing when you never know what the hell you're going to get from your offense and you have a stacked pitching staff.
Yeah, but look at the offense in 2010 versus the offense now. I think they're even better. You know, we had guys like Burrell, Uribe, Renteria, you know, yeah. Cody Ross, those aren't great players. Melky Cabrera is hitting .350. Buster Posey's performing at an all-star level. You know, Hunter Pence is going to hit at least .280. He's a solid guy in right field. I think the offense is better now. It's just going to take a second to come together. They're just all slumping at the wrong time. Sandoval's on the DL. But I think it's all going to look better in 7 to 10 days, and then we're not going to be freaking out like we are now.
Two more things before I let you go. First, what was a better moment in Giants history? The Bobby Thompson walk-off home run, 54, or Melky Cabrera winning the MVP of the All-Star game?
Considering I wasn't alive in 1951, I know you were, but
my great uncle was at that game. He had no idea. Like he was, we were at a family reunion, and he was talking about how, oh yeah, I went to this baseball game for the Giants, the playoff game, and my dad's like, you were at the Bobby Thompson game? He's like, yeah, there was a big home run hit. He had no idea the significance of the shot heard around the world, and he was there. So.
Well, when you don't get to hear the actual call, the Giants won the pennant, you really don't get to hear that. You don't really know what's going on. It just looks like another.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's definitely a. I think that's a good point. Because I think baseball more so, if you're there and you don't get to hear the call, it's probably not nearly as good.
Yeah, and if you're not cheering one way or the other, you know, you don't get to truly experience the whole emotion of the event. I mean, I don't care about hearing the call. I was at Game 4 of the NLCS Giants Phillies with my podcast partner Danny. We cheered our asses off that game, and when Aubrey Huff scored on Uribe's sack fly, we went bananas. I didn't need to hear Kirk Skype. I didn't need to hear a call because I was there and I felt it and I was so into that game. So I can totally understand the opposite where your relative was at the game and just, oh, hold on, that was exciting, and then walked away and grabbed a beer.
Well, did you like, I guess it would be with that home run, I mean, Is Bobby Thompson ahead of, I think the Matt Stairs home run against in Dodger Stadium was far more exciting in the playoffs. Because it was Matt Stairs.
Look, our greatest home run moment in San Francisco, because, you know, that happened in New York, is Edgar Renteria's three-run homer in Game 5 of the World Series against the Rangers. Because who the F saw that one coming?
No.
You know, Edgar Renteria was a sunk cost. We signed him 2 years, $16 million. He didn't perform 2 years, $8 million, you know, and then he hits a home run against Cliff Lee in the World Series to pretty much lock it up for the Giants. So that's just incredible. I'm getting goosebumps just talking about it.
Well, do Giants fans like Jon Miller?
We love proud to have Krug and Kipe, because we love them, Dave Fleming and Jon Miller on the radio side. We absolutely love them. The fact that Jon Miller does not work at ESPN during Sunday Night Baseball is atrocious. You know, he should be there. They keep hiring these homers, you know, Eric Karros, Eric Burns, Oral Hershiser, all these Dodgers and Diamondback homers who just hate on the Giants all day. And Jon Miller, you could never tell that he did radio for the Giants when he did national broadcast. And we respected that.
Well, I think the downfall of Jon Miller was Joe Morgan, because Joe Morgan was terrible. I thought Jon Miller, I don't mind Jon Miller, but I think Joe Morgan just brought out the worst in him.
Which is fine. It's really hard to find a good color guy. Look at Tim McCarver. I mean, he works with Buck on Fox, and he's terrible. You know, he plays down to the lowest common denominator. He never knows what he's talking about. I think it's just really hard to find a good color guy who gets to be funny and that fans like, but without insulting the diehards.
Well, I had to have a... I'm glad you brought up how terrible Tim McCarver is, because I had to... On my show earlier, I had about a 15-minute conversation with somebody who was defending Tim McCarver, and I just don't understand anybody who could possibly defend him. And... it's not, he doesn't have a good voice. He doesn't, he speaks the obvious. And do you remember Scooter, that stupid little baseball that they used to have on Fox Saturday Baseball?
I don't think I remember Scooter.
Well, Scooter was like, you got to look it up on YouTube. But as far as Scooter goes, it was this cartoon baseball that would explain what a four-seam fastball was, which is... It's unbelievably stupid. Well, my theory behind Scooter was the explanation of the pitch was something that McCarver had said earlier in the game or something, and they were just trying to make it like into a little kid's thing or divert the attention from how bad McCarver really was. And,
can I defend McCarver for a second?
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm going to fall on my sword. People blow me up on Twitter, but he does have to play to a national audience. You know, not everyone tuning into the nationally televised baseball game is a fan of one team or the other. You know, they're not necessarily diehard baseball fans. They're just on a Saturday afternoon looking to watch a sport. Weekend Warriors, you know. So he does have to kind of dumb it down. Not everybody who watches baseball knows the difference between a four-seam and a two-seam fastball. So he does have to play to that audience, and he's a baseball guy. You know, he's a baseball guy's baseball guy. He goes way back, played baseball, been around baseball. All the old baseball guys love him. So, you know, he has his merit, but I don't want to watch him pretty much ever.
No, and I mean, I think it was an alarming change when they took him out of the box, or when he was sick or whatever. He had something in the hospital last year, and Terry Francona went into the box, and just... it was night and day difference between how much better that telecast was.
Well, it's also hard to beat a guy who's just coming out of the game. You know, Francona had such insight into what was going on in Major League Baseball because he had just been managing for the better part of a decade. And when that happens, yeah, you're going to know a lot more than somebody whose job it is to just talk all day. So Francona had more insight than McCarver ever could, but they do need to find somebody, I think, younger and more in tune with what modern-day baseball fans are interested in.
I wish they would bring back Steve Lyons, actually.
He was pretty good. I like Steve Lyons. But, you know, I think there's good baseball guys out there. I think Dave Fleming for the Giants is a dark horse candidate. He's a great play-by-play guy. And such a nice guy. So I really think he has a future where Jon Miller kind of will leave off when his career ends.
Last thing before I let you go. Where do the Giants finish off? Where do the Dodgers finish off? And where did the Padres finish off?
Oh, man. I have so many Padres fan friends. It's fun to watch them roll around in dirt, kicking and screaming. I think the Giants are going to finish first place. Diamondback second. The Dodgers are third. I think the Dodgers are just going to miss the playoffs. But be ready for a big, big surge next year when they go out and make some moves in the offseason. And, you know, the Padres are our last place team. I'm actually going to win $20 if they don't win 80 games, so I'm looking forward to that money.
Well, yeah, that has to be rewarding, especially after they had that 10-game lead on you guys late in the season and they blew it.
I mean, that's part of Giants lore at this point. You know, they were overperforming and, you know, they eventually played down to their level and Giants played up to theirs. And that's baseball, man. Those late season runs are what make baseball really exciting. Checking the box score every day to see what happened. You know, looking for highlights to see if you creep an inch closer or an inch further away. So it makes baseball a lot of fun to watch.
One more thing. Do you want to tell everybody about GiantsPod and tell everybody where you can find it?
Oh, for sure. You can find us on iTunes, GiantsPod. You can find us on our website, GiantsPod.net. We're a San Francisco Giants podcast. We pontificate about the team, you know, talk about the lineup, you know, make fun of Bochy, stuff like that. It's a fun show. If you like the Giants, tune in. If you don't, tune in anyway. You know, we'll take the download.
Yeah, if you're a Padres fan, give up and start listening to the Giants podcast.
Absolutely. Come north. We'll take you. Bring us your tired, your poor, whatever it says on that on the Statue of Liberty.
I'm not sure. I don't even know what it says on the Statue of Liberty anymore.
My great grandparents immigrated here. They probably read it. I don't know. They've never told me. So.
Yeah, I know the immigration stories are always great, but I always forget the most important parts of them, because that's the thing with old people. They tell you the least important parts the most, and they tell you the most important parts the least.
Well, they like to tell you how much money they had in their pocket when they were on the boat over here. That's their most important fact. I had $8 in my pocket when I got to this country.
Well, and then it's like, it'll be like, so-and-so was at the family reunion that year. It's like, who cares? I want to hear about, I don't care if my nephew Jim was at the family reunion. I want to know more important facts than who was at a family reunion. I want to know about the immigration stories. Those are fun. Well, maybe not fun, but interesting.
Bring them on your show, Bob.
Yeah, the immigration hour with Bob Sullivan.
That's not bad. I might tune in.
All right, Thomas, I appreciate you coming on. We'll definitely do this again, hopefully with maybe a little more positivity from Giants fans.
We'll talk playoff time.
Okay, sounds good, man.